What makes us humans? What is the specificity of humans? We may discuss that, the capacity of language, the capacity to create, the inventivity, the creativity, the invention. I may go to another direction, consciousness. Consciousness of us living in a world where we know that we're just going to be there for a while, and a world that we think we may, since the beginning, have a control over it. Starting from the very beginning in the cave, humans were trying to represent the world they were living in. They were starting to grasp the world in a way to representing it with their hands. Then comes the great era of art, where the question of humans and relationship of humans with the world was about imitation. Just do an imitation of the world, but just representing paysage, bodies. And in the 19th and 20th century was a great era of fabrication. Let's do the world. We became God. In Renaissance, we basically believed in man more than God. We decided that the world may be ours, and we may design the world, and it was the era of production. But today, we are now at the era of simulation. Why? Just because there are no nature to copy. There are no more physics or world that will be outside of us. The world that we think was something we were able to control is actually us. We live in symbiotic with what we have created, and the world we live in is actually an artificial world from our hands. This is why we live an era of simulation. And this leads us to a big question is, do we continue to design products? That means things, as the world was coming to us with stones and matter and air and light, or something else happens. If we are living in the world, what is more important is not just to be over the world in design, but it's about being in the world and interact with. So the relationship, the link, the concordance, the convergence between us and the world is what we have to design now. Not the object, not the product, but the experience of us when we habitat the world. And it just leads us to a very important question is, we did have created other us, people that actually are machines. Machines that we call robots, cobots, machines. Yet, how are we going to be living in that world when we have to interact with robots? How we will simulate those new relationships? Because there are some things for sure designers will never, never do, is to follow the rules and guidelines. Wherever you decide to do some things, the human nature, the analog user, that Andrea will be discussing about, are completely unpredictable. So we may need to predict as much as we know, the things we know, but there are still a lot of things we don't know. This is why it's so important for this event to have the word design in front of modelization, modeling, and simulation. Because there are no means to model and simulate if you don't know why. So doing if-we scenarios to actually address what may be an experience, it's quite an important new value for designers. They are not only designing product, they are designing relationships, but on the top of it, they have to take this huge capacity that is coming from simulation to actually design in multi-scale and multi-space environment. So the design studio My name is Anne Asensio. I'm in charge in Dassault Systèmes of an innovation group called the Design Studio. We are designers. And we are trying to imagine what may be just your world as citizen, but also your world as professional in the very near future, when designers, modelers, simulators will be working together, breaking down the silos. And one thing that is clear is we need to learn how to design experiences. And what does it mean to design experiences? That is quite a complex task. So this is what the Design Studio is doing, leveraging the 3D experience platform and all of its solution. And we are doing it not just in a vacuum, that will have no means, but in an open way. We are designing it with you. We design and we imagine the future of how we can basically work on the platform with our customers. And we have a very simple track record. We design for impact. What it means? It means like when it comes to sustainable innovation, only thing matters is not what you have predicted, is did you succeed in your promise? Did you succeed in the promise of a great experience? So there are really two main areas. One is design or designing an experience is about new business model. It's about just like improving in a 360 perspective all of the aspect of what it takes the design to actually operate for impact in the real world. Second, we have to be human-centered. If we are technology-centered, we're going to go to the wall. We have to be human-centered because all of what we do have to come back to a good means for people. That's why we sense, we reflect, and we act, leveraging the 3D experience technology. The design process and design methodologies are very well known in the area of creativity. They are definitely the method for if-we scenarios. They are bridging, collaboration, participative design, inside and outside the company to fulfill the completely new, uncertain, and unknown scenarios for the future. And one of these is just this perfect correlation with all of the three main pillars of the transformation of our society: mobility, health, and living. To do so, we have just a simple methodology, is to bridge the design methodology to the system and simulation approach. And again, we are doing it with a different matrix than just the simulation feedback, the execution, I would say, of the requirements into a physical world. We are doing it by taking only one, because that's the only universal matrix that we can trust, the emotion. And to test that, we are regularly working with customers. And we met Andreas Ensling. We both met because we basically have the same train of thoughts. You're going to realize that very soon. And before we get into this presentation, I would like just to give you a little bit of insight of who is coming on stage next. Andreas Ensling is an industrial designer. He's graduate from Munich. He's a visionary man, in a way that very early in the 90s, he was already engaged in digital processes. He was already having this intuition that what we are doing today would be just the future. He had an intensive career also as a design manager. He worked for Grohe before he became the head of design since 2006 at Miele. So he's also, and this is quite important for designers' community, he's also a very important member of the Association of the Design Industrial Designers here in Germany, as I am in France. So please welcome on stage Andreas Ensling.
Anne, thank you very much for the introduction. Yeah, it's great to be here, and I'm glad that we could do a brief design lesson to get a little bit deeper into the area of design. For all of us, who don't know Miele. Miele is doing household appliances in the premium segment since 120 years now. And we reached now over 4.1 billion euros turnover. What I have prepared for my speech, and this is a design team in Gütersloh where we are placed, we have 42 designers, is that I would like to take you on a journey to user experience and design. Design has been one of Miele's success factors for many years, and with digitalization, the tasks of design are changing faster than ever. I think Anne have showed this to you before. When we look into the history, especially the ability of change played the biggest part in the long duration of Miele's history and success in the company. Now, the butter machines made of oak, wood or washing machines would have been enough for the continuance of Miele. The industrial design in analog times always tried to improve manufacturing processes to create better shapes and surfaces. From today, this was a simple job. You know, when I remember when I studied in the 80s, so we have always fights with the engineers to make the things happen. This has changed. You know, in the 80s, you know, we had a lot of analog time. We had a lot of things to design. Metallic touch keys of switches were developed on the basis of the first 8-bit, who remembers, microcontrollers. Nowadays, we are a step further from this. This was the 90s. In the 90s, the industrial design shaped user interfaces by ergonomics. I remember very well, so what to do in ergonomics, it was a big issue. Mental models to improve the perceived quality. The rapid increase of functions that microcontrollers and displays had made possible required a clear design and ordering system for orientation in order to explain the new previously unknown functions and make them accessible to users. When we look what happened, it is necessary to understand this picture. We created, together with the design, typical brand elements. Brand elements means it's not only a logo, it's much more typical things for the experience, like a button, like a turning knob. And even the sound was designed by the designers to create a typical experience for the brand. This was a beginning for the design for companies getting, in a very certain way, typical. A brand image creates expectations on the side of the customers. And then, a few years later, because the development process took a long time at Miele, mostly 3 up to 5 years, and then it comes to a product. And when we disappointed customers by delivering products not staying on the basis of the brand image, it is a bad thing. The product will fail. Especially in the premium segment, it's necessary to have this in mind. Yeah? And the other way around, it's true as well. The product and user experience design creates shapes, forms at least. After this, the brand design again. So expectation and fulfillment are linked together. But times have changed. The job of an industrial designer in analog times was an easy one. It was all about material manufacturing, shapes, colors, and so on. It was easy. We are facing a much bigger complexity. The problem nowadays is that we are looking on this incredible increase of technology. When we see this, even the the devices, the robots from the science fiction movies, I remember Star Wars very well of my youth, are now feasible. It's possible to do it. But those who could not follow this immense progress, we are human beings. We as humans have not followed this progress. Our evolution could not keep up with the evolution of technology. We simply don't understand anymore what works, why, and how. Our brains, which are designed for survival in forests or the grass steppes of this planet, are simply overwhelmed by the complexity of the technical possibilities available to us. People are enthusiastic about simple solutions. Products must be intuitive and fun to use. Today, designers build bridges, and this is important that you remember this. Designers build bridges between the disciplines in a company and between technology and users, and do not read instruction manuals anymore, unfortunately. Digitization is replacing more and more hardware. However, the complexity of our world continues to rise deeply as a result. We initially only switches and buttons were affected. Even bicycles now receive batteries and apps. Entire economic sectors are now being virtualized. Tour operators and taxi companies are just the beginning. What counts in an increasingly complex world is trust. Trust that something simply works. Trust in a brand simply to deliver reliable products. Trust is the new currency of our economy. This diagram shows that understanding is only possible if the signs and symbols that are inevitably communicated about the form can only be understood if there is a certain agreement in interpretation between the sender and the receiver. You wouldn't recognize a thing you don't know. You wouldn't recognize a thing you don't know. You couldn't see it. An object can therefore never be self-explanatory. This function already requires a corresponding agreement. The transfer of complex technology into simple applications has always been the task and core competence of designers. And it's really easy, really easy. This picture shows it. What does not change are the patterns that evolution has given us to survive. And these patterns have been very successful. We are now 7.5 billion people on this planet. One of these patterns is based on a quick, intuitive assessment of people, landscapes, or objects. We search for patterns and apply them unconsciously. One is that of beauty. Beautiful people we trust more easily, and we consider them be healthy. I would like to do an experiment now with you. Imagine you are a lion. We are in Africa. It's very hot. Could you see the heat? Very hot. And we are hungry. No breakfast this morning. Hungry, heat. And now you see a herd of antelopes coming up on the horizon. You see them? You're hungry. One antelope in the herd is moving different. It's limping. Which one will you take? Easy decision. You took this decision in 1 second. It's a pattern. Pattern of healthiness, pattern of beautiness. It's easy. Who Who has a pet? Give me a hand signal. Great. It's more than the half of the audience. And I'm sure you also gave your pet a name. I'm sure you will have a family member. Your pet is a family member. And you adapted yourself, your environment, and your habits to your pet in some way, right? Examples? Who spends New Year's Eve, because of all the noises, with their horse, goes out with the dog at night, or perhaps has built in a cat flap in the house? This is Aibo from Sony, a robot dog. It was launched by Sony in 1999, and it was a sensational success. The entire first edition was sold out within 18 minutes. In 1999, I remember. Finally, in 2005, the production was stopped, and a lot of customers were heavily disappointed about Sony's decision. And what happens when a pet dies, when your dog, your cat dies? What do you do with this dog, with a dead dog? Do you do it in a garbage can? No. And of course, even an artificial pet is not thrown away. It's a family member, don't remember? No? Even when it not longer works. This is a shrine. The shrine was founded in Izumi in Japan, and it was for the Aibo robo pets and others. It's a temple, a shrine, and there the souls of the robot pets could find peace. I know it's a very cultural thing from Japan, but why is it so? Why do we treat robots like living beings? What is behind it? We believe in the form, movement, behavior of autonomously acting machines, something like intention, intelligence, or feeling, because of the patterns that are laid out in us. Remember the lines. Our so-called mirror neurons in our brains, and we have Stonehenge brains, make us believe that an autonomously driving car or a robot that smiles on us is friendly. And again, evolutionary patterns. What happens if some suddenly smiles on you on a subway? Almost everyone also reacts with a smile. These emotional reactions are a human heritage of evolution that now meets a world where there are more products than people. A robot that smiles me when I smile at it is perceived as a being and not as a machine. And I have brought with me a small video excerpt from Dr. Katie Darling. She showed this with her work, from which I would like to show you now an example. Have fun.
There was a day about 10 years ago when I asked a friend to hold a baby dinosaur robot upside down. It was this toy called a Pleo that I had ordered, and I was really excited about it because I've always loved robots. And this one has really cool technical features. It had motors and touch sensors, and it had an infrared camera. And one of the things it had was a tilt sensor, so it knew what direction it was facing. And when you held it upside down, it would start to cry. And I thought this was super cool, so I was showing it off to my friend. And I said, ooh, hold it up by the tail, see what it does. So we're watching the theatrics of this robot struggle and cry out. And after a few seconds, it starts to bother me a little. And I said, okay, that's enough now. Let's put him back down. And then I pet the robot to make it stop crying. And that was kind of a weird experience for me. For one thing, I wasn't the most maternal person at the time. Although since then I've become a mother 9 months ago, and I've learned that babies also squirm when you hold them upside down. But my response to this robot was also interesting because I knew exactly how this machine worked, and yet I still felt compelled to be kind to it. And that observation sparked a curiosity that I've spent the past decade pursuing. Why did I comfort this robot? And one of the things I discovered was that my treatment of this machine was more than just an awkward moment in my living room. That in a world where we're increasingly integrating robots into our lives, an instinct like that might actually have consequences. Because the first thing that I discovered is that it's not just me. In 2007, the Washington Post reported that the United States military was testing this robot that defused landmines. And the way it worked was, it was shaped like a stick insect, and it would walk around a minefield on its legs, and every time it stepped on a mine, one of the legs would blow up, and it would continue on the other legs to blow up more mines. And the colonel who is in charge of this testing exercise ends up calling it off, because he says it's too inhumane to watch this damaged robot drag itself along the minefield. Now, what would cause a hardened military officer and someone like myself to have this response to robots? Well, of course, we're primed by science fiction and pop culture to really want to personify these things. But it goes a little bit deeper than that. It turns out that we're biologically hardwired to project intent and life onto any movement in our physical space that seems autonomous to us.
Thank you very much. Just an excerpt. It's worth to see the whole video. It's on YouTube, not difficult to get there. So two things to remember. Emotional reactions to products are the result of our evolutionary history, and we tend to project human-like qualities, emotions, characteristics, and behaviors onto human beings. There's a big impact on the development of machines, of devices, of robots. It's a big impact because we have to change our kind of thinking, how to doing the development. User-centric means it's on you, it's your emotion. And it's not possible to design the emotion on a single person. It's only possible to design the relationship between a product and a person to create emotions. Especially the interaction of complex technologies with people, virtual prototypes can be a way to integrate these emotional reactions we are designing into the product development. But please, not when you are finished. The merging of simulated interfaces with simulated environments, software simulations, 3D data models, digital twins, and so on, images, at least, with real people and their feelings and possibilities allow an iterative adaptation during the development phase. So this interaction, iterative development is the key. Simulation enables people and later users to involve them in the development stage, and thus users and not technology are finally at the center of the development. How can these emotional reactions be taken into account in product development? This was a question what we hopefully have answered. How can form and interaction be designed as a unit as early as possible in the design process? And this is due to our evolutionary perception. We at Miele started a few years ago with our first vacuum cleaner robots. When we held design thinking workshops to develop user-centered ideas for this product, we are particularly amazed at one result. Almost all users had given their autonomous vacuum cleaner robot a name. We had never heard of washing machines and ovens like this before. Robots seem to address people in a special way. They occupy a special position among machines. Unlike excavators or televisions, they are treated almost humanly. This is due to our evolutionary process. Here you can see how important the design of a robot is for the acceptance and thus for the function itself. These four are nursing care robots. But how can emotional reactions, a smile, a sense, a well-being reaction, trust, and expectations be recorded and evaluated in user tests? What will happen if users do not feel comfortable with the test situation? Imagine, yeah, when you're doing testings and you are wearing goggles, VR goggles, using flight sticks and this stuff, it's easy to struggle and easy that you will see that people do not really feel good with this. Yeah. You get not the results you have to get. We cannot survive alone without others. We need the others. We have to adjust our behavior to the behavior to others. We can read out from facial expressions, gestures, and of course the voice in seconds how the other person is doing. Laughing, crying, is innate and works it independently from cultures worldwide. These emotional reactions are human heritage of evolution that now meets a world in which there are more products than people. The performance of the technologies available to us enables machines to behave increasingly like living creatures. Here, two, there is an evolution that will perhaps produce machines in the future that will hardly differ from or even surpass those of humans in terms of their capabilities. However, we humans will not be able to keep up with this evolution. We will therefore experience that robots and intelligent systems change our behavior as humans as well. So we have the things vice versa. This environment will influence our behavior. How do you interact with an Amazon Alexa? How do you interact with a robot? So technical things are influencing our behavior. So our culture is changing. To achieve this, it makes no sense to adapt people to technology. Now remember, technology is increasing tremendously. User tests in virtual environments are therefore not yet possible. It is much better if we adapt the technology to people's habits. 7.5 billion people and 12 billion smartphones leave no questions unanswered. The smartphone is now almost something like a part of your body. Why not using this for user tests? And this is something we would like to show you now. Now I want to show you something really exciting. User testing together with a 3D experience platform can also include real people and their needs at a very early stage in the development process by using a smartphone. The smartphone allows us as a sensor a direct interaction together with the 3D experience platform. This is an experiment, so we are not ready yet, but we will show you a first demo It's a totally unknown field. I think the last few weeks we have worked here hard, and yeah, look at it, and then we could discuss.
So now it's time to go live. First time, first of its kind. This is just a prototype, not just finished. And to actually show you the demo live, I would like to have Sébastien Smetrens from the design studio that work on this proposition with the team of Andreas. And we're very, very pleased to show you this live. So just excuse us. We have to just plug the computer there.
When we started it, Anne, it was an interesting discussion how to do it. And I think what we really got in this cooperation is to see how important it was to get over the silos, to have a process directly from an idea, it was nothing more than an idea, into the design center of Dassault. Then to the engineering department in Dassault, we had a lot of video conferences the last time, the last few weeks. And to see the progress was really amazing for me, to see what happens to make the idea a reality.
And this is what you have to understand. We have all of the means, we have the solutions, but this was an experiment. And it's very promising in a way that in the future, we will have tools and solutions to design experiences. Even with the big amount of means that we talk about is the emotion, including the unpredictability of human or robot or pets reactions. So do you have the phone?
Yep. We're here. Just a moment. Yeah, for us it was interesting to see that it really works, and it's open now as a development for new questions. So we try to make it a little bit wider. Now we are using a smartphone by touching it, but in future, because we have a lot of built-in sensors there, and it's a kind of a natural interface for most of our customers. We could use voice. We could make a voice connection directly to the 3D experience platform. We could use the tilt sensor.
Gesture. 3D
we could
gesture.
Use for with the cameras in some of the smartphones for gesture.
Yeah.
So all these sensors are given. We have this in our hands. And what is a really, really huge advantage, you don't need to train people for this. You could ask everybody directly in a test situation. Yeah, we could require people from the street asking
them. And Andreas, I would like just for people to understand, this is to just pilot a robot by phone. That's something already know. We know that does exist. But to use it in a perspective of designing if-we scenarios, this is really where we have a strike or a breakthrough.
So what we see now, it's an interface. We have to create an interface as well together with the product. And the interaction between the human being, the user, the interface itself, and the product now is possible. In former times, it was necessary to do it step by step. Then maybe have some improvements. You failed. You go back in the loop. You have to do again a prototype, you have to do again a new interface, and so
this
on.
Is really what we really see is, it's not about modeling or design or simulation, it's the quick iteration, as many as we want, during the process of thinking.
So, look at this, I'm starting the virtual robot in a virtual kitchen on a prototyped interface by a real human. So it's running now, it's doing now its job, collecting all the dirt, making some orientation, going along the furniture, and then there's a small problem, so it stops. Now we get a message.
Yeah. Some water.
So, something occurs here, maybe I'm in my office at work, so I can react. So, oh, I don't know what it is, go back to the garage. So it's going back, direct interaction. So another scenario, and this is what I'd like to show you here, is to compare two scenarios together with a real user. The second scenario is same thing. Do the job. But in this scenario, when it comes to a stop, we have a different situation. And yeah, you see it's really, really easy to have different scenarios in one simulation. It's just a mouse click. So now we have a different thing. And look at that. This is really weird. So you did a really great job. Look at this. We have a virtual picture from the virtual environment done by a virtual camera on a natural interface on a smartphone. You give back. This is the first time we bring things out of a virtual environment directly to a real user. And now we see the picture here. We see what happened. Yeah? So for the user, it's a scenario to decide by himself what is necessary now. Should I interact now? Should I send the robot back? Should I drive around or whatever? And if I already mentioned, it's possible in the scenario to switch maybe the angle of the camera. Maybe we now see, oh, it's not so comfortable. Maybe it's better to look a little bit more from above, or we have to have a different angle for the camera view. So all these things are given.
The robot seeing some of the other people in the room and not just this basic task that he has to do. So it's just opening up completely new interactions.
It's opening up a huge amount of possibilities. We now are, we have started to discover this, what is possible with it. So I'm really amazed, you feel it, about this technology and these possibilities for the design department, because now when products get more complex, it's necessary to have a different kind of user testing at a very early stage, in a collaboration of all the professions. It's necessary now to get a step ahead.
So to conclude, I would like just to go to one single slide. Something that is quite important is we have the capacity within the 3D Experience platform. It's just like a completely new way to assemble the team, the new plateau of designers, engineers, researchers, to actually fulfill this extraordinary and unpredictable task of designing experiences. So this may conclude our presentation. Thank you, Andreas.
Thank you, Anne. Thank you, Sebastian.
Thank you.
Thank you.
See you soon.